Day 6, intrapartum complication. As always, we're using the nursing process to plan family-centered care. For day 6, we're looking at the intrapartum period, so high-risk deliveries, high-risk births that develop either in the intrapartum period or extend from antepartum. Talk about some complications of delivery that impact the outcome of both the mom and the baby. Looking at nursing diagnoses that are appropriate and thinking about nursing care for that woman throughout the intrapartum period. Dystocia is a catch-all term that refers to labor that's not progressing the way it is expected to. There are some standards about how long labor should be and what the typical process should involve. So dystocia occurs because there is a disruption in either passengers, passageway, or with powers. A lot has to do with powers. If you recall, powers were contractions and pushing. The first is precipitous delivery. And with a precipitous delivery, it's progressing extremely fast with very strong contractions, intense contractions, and labor goes from no contractions to ready to deliver, as far as the woman believes, in less than 3 hours. The contractions may not have been fully effective, though. She may not be at 10 centimeters when she feels the urge to push. So one of the important nursing roles are to identify whether or not she is fully dilated, and if she's not, to sort of coach her to not push. The other thing is there may not be a provider present at the time that she comes in because she gets rushed up to a maternity triage and immediately gets brought into a room. And if there does not happen to be providers in the building, the nurses may be the ones that are doing this delivery because it happens so rapidly. So the risk of her pushing too soon is that there could be cervical tears or vaginal tears and bleeding complicating the delivery. A little bit different from precipitous delivery is a hypertonic labor pattern. So these are also intense contractions, but they aren't rapidly progressing. They are ineffective in that the cervix is not dilating at the rate it should be. They can be distinguished from Braxton Hicks contractions because they are so strong and they may have started some dilation and effacement of the cervix, but the cervix isn't progressing and the contractions end up then shifting to a more irregular pattern and the whole process is dysfunctional. A lot of times it could be due to maternal anxiety. But the other common cause is back labor. Posterior position of the baby results in a lot of painful labor and results in these ineffective contractions. Alternatively, hypotonic labor, she's had some contractions, really kind of mild. The cervix started to dilate and efface, and then nothing much was happening. The uterus is a muscle. If it has been stretched excessively previously, perhaps that could have an impact on why it's unable to contract effectively in this particular delivery. This also can occur when there's multiples. So contractions have started to move along and then they sort of stop. Nursing interventions such as encouraging nipple stimulation or perhaps an enema might facilitate that. Those contractions, enemas have an effect on contractions because they stimulate the rectum, the volume of water, as well as the heat will stimulate contractions. Now, in a woman who's having normal contractions, an enema is not helpful at all, but for hypotonic labor, that could be an intervention that nurses could suggest to the provider. Structural dystocia is a function of the passenger and the passageway. Probably the one that is most common is a shoulder dystocia. So as that baby turns with cardinal movements, they aren't really turning effectively to get their shoulders under mom's pubic bone. So the one shoulder, possibly both shoulders, can get stuck, and that can result in either stretching or tearing of the brachial plexus, and the injury associated with it could be Erb's palsy. For some structural dystocias, a C-section might be the plan by the provider based on what is causing the structural dystocia. But for a shoulder dystocia, McRoberts maneuver is what you'll see. Remember, the baby's head is pretty much out and just the shoulder is holding them in. With this position, mom's legs both are being pulled back really far, and usually there's a nurse that's getting up above the mother and is pushing down with the palm of her hand onto the mom's abdomen just above the symphysis pubis to try to get that baby's shoulder to go under. Providers will try to manipulate the baby throughout this process. They will try to pull the shoulders closer together and may even result in a fractured clavicle as part of that. This is of significant concern because there's not a lot you can do when the head is pretty much out or mostly out. And this situation is very concerning because there aren't a lot of options to get that baby out. They can't go back and take her to a C-section and pull the baby back in to do a C-section. So it requires lots of manipulation of mom and possibly the use of instruments, as well as the provider trying to turn the baby to get them out. Remember, shoulder presentation is not the same as shoulder dystocia. Shoulder presentation had a transverse lie, and this baby cannot be delivered vaginally and would be a C-section. Shoulder dystocia, we're pretty far along in this delivery. Baby's head is out and the shoulder may not be. Very different situation. Other structural dystocias could result in a C-section. Cephalopelvic disproportion and fetal anomalies would be identified on ultrasound prior to the delivery. Cephalopelvic disproportion means really big head, not getting through mom's pelvis, and that's one of the reasons why the provider would have documented the measurements for mom's pelvis. Certain fetal anomalies could make it more difficult for the baby to successfully deliver vaginally. There are numerous organ ectrophies that could have a serious negative effect if the baby delivered vaginally. Ectrophied kidneys, ectrophied liver, ectrophied bladder, or ectrophied heart. Another structural dystocia is the large for gestational age baby who could be an infant of a diabetic mother, but may not be, could just be large from other reasons. So those babies, if they had been identified via sonogram, is might be a recommendation to mom for a C-section. Sometimes there's a uterine inversion, which means the uterus just comes right out with the placenta. So the placenta doesn't actually detach appropriately. It's sort of like pulling your hand out of your sweater sleeve. The rest of the sleeve comes out. So this is something that requires a surgical repair. So mom does have to go to the OR for that so it can be reinserted. It's not an emergency situation, but it is something that is addressed immediately. The other complication with the uterus is an emergency, and that is if there's a uterine rupture. Now, this is the reason or the concern for why providers may not want to risk a vaginal birth after C-section, because there is a concern that the uterus could have a tear along the line of where the previous C-section scar was. A uterine rupture can be very small, just the size of a pinky fingertip, or there could be a complete separation running either transverse across the previous scar or vertically up and down the abdomen. Mom may suddenly have sharp pain that's continuing in between contractions, and she may not have any contractions at all. Contractions may all of a sudden cease, or there may only be contractions in part of her abdomen. Lots of variations. This is absolutely an obstetrical emergency. They have to get her back to the OR right away because she will start bleeding and can bleed profusely depending upon the size of the rupture. Umbilical cord complication. We do check with the umbilical cord to see if it's wrapped around the baby's neck or wrapped around the baby's other body parts. Was it loose versus tight? Were there any actual true knots in it? Or was it just looped back upon itself so it didn't really look like a knot? How many times was it looped around the baby's neck? Those are all things that indicate how much stress the baby may have been under. The other complication of umbilical cord prolapse, we've already identified as an obstetrical emergency, means that they need to go down for a stat section to prevent fetal distress. Hopefully there is no fetal distress happening at that moment. A multiparous woman has been in labor. Her membranes have just ruptured. The nurse's initial response is to assess the fetal heart rate and pattern to make sure that there's no changes as a result of those membranes rupturing. Then you progress to observing the characteristics of the fluid. If this was a spontaneous rupture of membranes, you'd be notifying the provider. If it was an artificial rupture of membranes, then the provider's there. Cord prolapse can occur in a breech presentation, in a shoulder presentation, if there's rupture of membranes because there's so much space in between there, if the baby's in a transverse lie, or it can also occur with a baby in a vertex phallic position if they're high and they're floating and have not actually become engaged before there's rupture of membrane. The picture on the bottom could look like the nurse is pushing the cord back in or touching the cord. Absolutely, the nurse is not doing that, and neither would the provider. The nurse is pushing the baby's head back so that it's not obstructing or compressing the cord. So this is happening en route to the OR, and the nurse may stay underneath the table, pushing back on that baby's head as the providers start the section. You might also see if they're not ready, there's no provider in-house. You may see moms being turned on hands and knees to accomplish that same goal of just pulling the baby's head through gravity off the cervix a little bit so that there's some space and less potential for compression of the cord. Placenta complications. There's a variety of ways that the placenta can attach to the uterus abnormally. You don't really need to memorize this for our exam, but just be aware of the fact that there are a variety of ways. You might in some of your clinical sites actually see a higher incidence of accreta, say that is common in the population, but that's because there are high-risk obstetricians that specialize in managing those pregnancies. I may have mentioned before that substances do impact the placenta, such as smoking and cocaine or other kinds of drugs can have an influence on the health of the placenta, causing infarcts or just an inability for the baby to get the nutrients and oxygenation they need. Amniotic fluid complications can include meconium. I spoke about meconium aspiration syndrome on day 4 on the neonate. Meconium can be just flecks of meconium through the amniotic fluid. There could be streaks, or it could be to the extent where it looks like pea soup. Pea soup meconium indicates the baby's been under a lot of stress and has expressed meconium possibly several times to the point that it's diffused throughout the amniotic fluid. When there is rupture of membranes, what you're looking at with color is to see whether or not there is any meconium there. When the provider identifies that there is meconium in the amniotic fluid, Many times they will call to have a pediatric team or NEO team present at the delivery in case the baby needs to be resuscitated. An infection in the amniotic fluid is called chorioamnionitis. I'm going to talk about that in just another minute. Other things that can develop with amniotic fluid include polyhydramnios or oligohydramnios. Polyhydramnios sometimes means excessive amniotic fluid. The amniotic fluid index is a particular measurement in the biophysical profile. It could also be identified in an ultrasound earlier and may indicate that there is the potential for certain types of fetal anomalies. Oligohydramnios could also indicate a fetal anomaly. With polyhydramnios, there could be a tracheal-esophageal fistula. With oligohydramnios, there could be kidney problems. The baby's not peeing enough for there to be a sufficient amniotic fluid. The other thing that could have happened with an oligo is mom could have had an amniotic fluid leak. With oligo, the provider might consider doing an amnio infusion. Normal saline fluid is inserted into the uterus, and that provides an additional cushion to reduce the potential for cord compression. Amniotic fluid emboli is a really rare condition. It has a very high mortality. And what happened is there's an emboli in the mom system that includes some amniotic fluid and perhaps other fetal cells and can result in a cardiac arrest or a stroke or something else along that line. The typical results of an emboli, but it's unusual and it's not really well understood how that emboli formed into the mom's system. Intrapartal infections include chorioamnionitis, which the nickname is chorio. If mom develops a fever and has other symptoms that are indicative of an infection, then a CBC would be ordered to confirm if there is any infection developing. Similar to the postpartum metritis infection, mom could have foul-smelling amniotic fluid, but may not. If she's in preterm labor with ruptured membranes, this would be a situation where we do not want the baby to stay in utero because that benefit of the surfactant is not going to outweigh the respiratory complications the baby will have if they contract an infection. I talked about lacerations and episiotomies previously, but here just talking about perineal trauma as a laceration, it's important to see the difference between the various degrees. The Mayo Clinic has excellent pictures. So this is the anatomy. Here's a first degree tear. Sometimes you can't even see a first degree tear. It's not that prominent. It may not need sutures, and it may be farther up into the vagina. This is a second degree tear. Usually does need stitches. Mom may have more discomfort associated with this. A third degree tear extends into the muscle around the anal sphincter. These are quite complex to repair and can lead to complications such as incontinence and dyspareunia. A fourth degree tear extends all the way into the rectal mucosa, quite extensive, and may require plastic surgery subsequent. The patient will most probably be incontinent. Fourth degree and to a certain extent, third degree vaginal tears are considered significant enough that it would tear again in a subsequent delivery. So having had a fourth degree tear is an indication for a C-section in subsequent deliveries. A fourth degree laceration is considered a sentinel event. I'll talk about what sentinel events are on day 7. ACOG expects that there will be a possibly first degree laceration in most deliveries. However, that third or fourth degree laceration is considered a lack of quality care. And it's called an OASIS, an obstetrical anal sphincter injury. Perineal massage is probably not utilized anywhere near as much as it should be. More recently, there have been some YouTube videos about it, but it's not something that is taught but could be taught in childbirth education classes. There's products out there for women to use, oils or lotions to assist with perineal massage, and that just helps relax that tissue. Warm compresses on the perineum during second stage and giving that mom enough time to wait for that urge to push. If she's waiting for the urge to push, her perineum can be relaxed and less likely to have a laceration. In addition, being in other positions besides lithotomy, where your legs are up and spread to a position that is most stressful on the perineum, could be helpful as well. So if she's on the side while pushing or in other positions, it can definitely reduce the stress on the perineum. There are certainly some risk factors for a perineal laceration. If it's a really big baby, then that could be a problem. If the mom had a lot of back labor for a long period of time, that does increase the likelihood of her having a perineal laceration. Unfortunately, first-time deliveries, there's more likely to be a laceration, which if she has a second or third degree laceration, could result in a laceration in a subsequent delivery. If she had to be induced for labor, then this is progressing at a rate that may be faster than her perineum can adjust to. Epidural, with an epidural, she has no idea how to push and has no idea, she's not waiting for the urge to push. And so that can increase the likelihood of a laceration. A prolonged second stage means that she's at 10 centimeters. We're waiting for her urge to push and it's not actually happening. So we're there for a much longer period of time, or she's pushing for a very long period of time. One of the goals of an episiotomy is to prevent a laceration from being more severe. So with good quality care, an episiotomy might be appropriate, just a 1 cm episiotomy to prevent a further tear. But if it's midline, it could definitely have a tear as well as the episiotomy. And anytime anything else is introduced, whether it's forceps or the vacuum, that is applying pressure to that perineum that could result in a laceration. A previous class put together this poster for evidence-based practice